Right away, you put this guy in. Now, I want to to say thank you to everybody that's brought dishes every night, everybody that's come here. I don't think anybody has had a bad meal, a bad time, or a bad song, or a bad service. And I'm telling you, I'm behind the phone bit. You know what? I might lie once a year. If you ask my wife, I don't know. But I never lie here. I'm afraid of what God talks about, them old false witnesses in the Old Testament. So I think I can truthfully say, and everybody agree, that's some of the most beautiful singing that I've ever heard.
Amen.
That was awesome.
Yes.
And somebody said if she preaches better than she sings, we're in for a treat, and I believe that's right. And I've never heard, I tell everybody, I've heard her pray in school, and I thought it was just awesome. And I had her in mind, and I was talking to Don Williams one day going to school, and I said, you know, I'm going to have April come, I think. I said, the way she prays, I said, I really think that, you know, she's got the spirit. And he said, I'm going to tell you right now, you never heard her preach. I said, no. He said, she's awesome.
Bless her, Lord.
So I've had preachers tell me how wonderful she is. And I don't remember all who they were, but you'll never forget Don Williams when he talks to you. So, will you? You'll never forget Don Williams. And he told me how great she preached. So I can only truthfully testify to him. But I'm going to tell you, I can't wait. But I want you to know you can't have a revival without everybody, right?
Amen.
God said this is a house of prayer. And I've told y'all before that the congregation's prayers is the most important part of church. The second part is the song leader, the pianist, to those who sing, and then I come in third. Because it is a house of prayer. You can't get saved without prayer. You can't do anything without prayer. And apparently the disciples do this because they asked Jesus to teach them. So you can learn how to pray, can't you? We need to teach our children how to pray.
Yes.
And we need to teach our neighbors and everybody else we can pray. And pray with faith. I pray for each and every one of you here. I'm going to when I go home tonight. I'll pray again when I'm at work driving around in that car. Because you think it's a bunch of garbage, but I'm telling you, preachers appreciate blessed congregation. And I've said it before, I know that God, I wasn't ready to preach until I come to these three churches. And you taught me how to preach. And I couldn't ask for a better church. And I know that there's other good churches out there. And I know one day I'll have to go. And I'll be heartbroken and cry when that happens. But you know what? If the First Methodist Church of Honolulu calls, I'm out of here. Brother Otis, do you want to do the opening prayer? Would you like me to? I know that. Okay, I'll be glad to do it. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, God, I want to thank you so much for, first of all, God, your Son. Your spirit, and mostly God, for your long suffering and patience. I think oftentimes when we have people that upset us and we're troubled with things and we want to lash out or we want to talk about people, do we need to remember what you've done for us? How you've turned yourself from wrath to love and how your mercy renews every day and how all these things go on. So let us, God, show our appreciation in our prayers tonight, in our songs tonight. God, when we pray, to earnestly pray with one another, and God, when we hear your word, to accept the Spirit, God, so that later on when we need your help and we say, God, how come you didn't warn me? You say, my spirit was there that night, why didn't you listen? God, help us to be attentive, God, so that we'll always be on guard, because we don't have to worry. Just care about life when we have you in our life. We thank you for that and ask your blessing on these things tonight for the praise and honor and glory to you, your Son Jesus, your Holy Spirit, and your Word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Y'all are wondering why I keep moving. I can hear better when I'm not behind somebody. So you Is our phone with Randy? He came up to me last night and says, I want you to hear a poem that I wrote. Or no, he said, I want you to hear a poem. I said, okay. And he got on his phone, and he got it up and started reading it. And I said, who was that from? So I thought he was reading from a book that he got. So I said, I wrote that. I said, you wrote that? He said, yeah. So I wanted him to share with you all night because I thought it was really good.
Yes.
Hello, how are y'all tonight? Such views given to us by our Lord God. He gives us a chance to say goodbye to our sins and accept them. He sent us on to die for our sins, to look high into the sky on him. He created beautiful views to show that he loves us by making the land beautiful and letting us live in our world.
Amen. Hey. Y'all did good up there.
Boy, I was just sharing another special song with this one. We're going to sing one more. And I remind you that here at Oak Hill, we don't think of an offering. We have a finance committee. I'm Gene Pascal, Santa Battles, and Teresa Rushing. I'm here, and if you'd like to contribute to the expenses of our revival, you're welcome to see one of them before you leave. 576, take the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
original, beautiful thing you have here. And it's glory to God. And I'm just so thankful to be here. I appreciate the meal so very much. God bless y'all. I appreciate the children that came and sang. I appreciate the young man that shared his poem and his heart. I appreciate this young lady who has taken up what has quickly become a lost art of playing the piano. And I'm humbled by your words, my brother. And next time I see Don Williams, I'm just going to kick him in the shin. But what an immense blessing it is to declare the word of the Lord.
Amen.
To be in God's house with God's people. Whether I know you or not, we all know each other because the Christ in each one of us recognizes the Christ in the other. It's a beautiful thing. I'm also, let me just say, very blessed by I got four sweet ladies that came from one of my churches, and God bless them, they were with me Sunday and Monday, and now here they are. And I just feel so blessed. I pray you came seeking tonight. I pray you came expecting and believing tonight. I pray you have come here tonight for revival. So what does that mean? Well, here are just a few of the dictionary definitions of the word revival. An improvement in the condition or strength of something, an act or instance of renewed attention to or interest in something, restoration of force, validity, or effect. Now, all these definitions are fine, but they are the world's definitions. What I am more concerned with is this question. What about the Christian definition of revival? And maybe even the better question would be, what is God's definition of revival? A spiritual revival can be defined as when God touches a community of the faithful. Another aspect of the definition of revival is an extraordinary movement of the Holy Spirit. Revival is a time of repentance and reuniting with God. At its essence, it is to re-encounter God. You see, I often have more questions the more that I learn. Anybody else? That happens to me a lot. So all these definitions lead me to wonder what we may need more than revival is to live in the first place. Just saying. Life is hard. I have been through the fire. Literally and in a figurative sense. Have you been through the fire? Well, I've got good news for you tonight. If you have been through the fire, maybe you are still in the fire. Maybe you've come through the fire, but you're left asking why. We're going to turn to God's eternal word for the answers to inspire us, to free us and to get us through the fire. Because if you had not been through the fire, it's coming. We're first going to look at the Old Testament prophet Daniel. We're going to be looking in chapter 3. I will begin with verse 16. But before we read the word of the Lord, let's go to Him once again in prayer. Precious God, who are we that you are even mindful of us? And yet, you are our ever-present help in times of trouble. So Lord, as we read your word once again tonight, we believe it is living and active. We believe that it has the power to change us and transform us. So we submit ourselves to you. We lay out our hearts. Open our eyes, our ears. Open our minds. Precious God, I ask for a double portion of the Holy Spirit upon each one here tonight. Reveal yourself in an undeniable way. This is the last night of revival. Some folks have been here every night. And they felt something. May this be the night that the Holy Spirit brings them home. So that you can begin to bring them through the fire into the glory of your perfect will. All these things we ask and pray believing in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Once again, Daniel chapter 3, we're going to begin with verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. And he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and his attitude toward them changed. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual, and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So these men, wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent, and the furnace was so hot, that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these 3 men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, weren't there 3 men that we tied up and threw into the fire? They replied, certainly, your majesty. He said, look, I see 4 men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the 4th looks like a son of the gods. Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire. And the satraps, prefects, governors, and royal advisors crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair of their heads singed. Their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own God." Brothers and sisters, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah and amen. I have come through the fire. Now this passage not only pulsates with drama, but it's a thrilling account of courage and of faith. Daniel chapter 3 is a test of the believer's worship. We discover here what it is to take a stand for the Lord and to refuse to compromise with the gods of this world. And there are plenty of them. Take hope in knowing that our times in the fire are for a purpose. It is for our learning. It is for our assurance. It is for our strengthening. And I'll go a step further and say, I believe it's also for our witnessing. Amen. During our times in the fire, we learn our limitations. We realize we can't fix everything. No amount of money, no amount of good works. As Jesus teaches us in Matthew chapter 5, "But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have?" When we are in the fire, it causes us to reach out to God.
Amen.
The one who should be our first resort is often our last resort. God, forgive us. It should not be that way. But we are promised in James chapter 8, verse 4, that if we draw near to God, he will draw near to us. That's a promise. The fires in life we come through reveal the saving grace and the love of our God. Mm-hmm. For some reason, God is easier to see in the fire. Mm-hmm. And not only is God's love and grace revealed to us, it is revealed to all those around us.
Amen.
Who see us in the fire and see us walk out.
Amen.
I have come through the fire. As you may or may not know, one of the churches I serve, Mason's Chapel, which these sweet ladies are from, our church building was struck by arsonists 10 days before Christmas last year. So I'm coming from a fresh and tender and vulnerable place as I felt led to speak about the subject of fire tonight. tonight. As I sat outside the church that morning, it was a cold, wet, dark, windy, miserable day. And smoke billowed out of that building. I hurt, but I did not crumble. That's because that was not the first time I had been through the fire. I got baggage. I got issues. I got stuff. Anybody else got some stuff? Some of the fire seemed to have randomly struck me like lightning. Some were set by the free will of others who wished me harm. Some fires I gathered wood and set myself. But no matter how I ended up in the fire, Jesus was there with me.
That's right.
Amen.
In the Old Testament book of Joshua and in the New Testament book of Hebrews, we are promised He will never leave us nor forsake us. Here is what the Lord has taught me about all the fires that I've walked out of. When bad things happen, God wants our character to succeed more than our circumstances. That means we will not always achieve our hoped for or prayed for or expected outcome. But it's about going through bad things the right way. It's about being obedient to God. It's about worshiping no other God but Him and trusting Him through the fire. Yes, you have been through a lot. So have I. So have every one of us in here. And guess what? So is every one of them out there outside our walls. We've all been through fire. The blessing we know is that Jesus is in the fire and that we'll get through it. And they need that. They need that. So here's a crazy idea. Allow God to use whatever it is you have been through or whatever it is you're going through, whatever it is you will go through to help somebody. Sometimes circumstances come our way that we didn't choose. But we must recognize these as opportunities to glorify God.
Amen.
We make it all too often about us, and we so often forget we are not our own. We have been bought with a price by the very blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
God can use the times when we mess up. Those times when we willfully sin. He can turn those into opportunities for His good and His glory. Not that I suggest doing that. But that's how wonderful and awesome and loving our God is. No one goes from absolutely right to teetotally wrong in a day. It's step by step. It's choice by choice. And here's the thing. Because of any fires that maybe we have chosen to build, or maybe those that we saw that we chose to walk into, whether we knew they were fires or not, we can recognize some of the signs and symptoms in others. We have the opportunity to be a witness, to be an example, to listen, to be a mentor, to disciple, to love, and to gently guide and share our experiences in a loving, helpful way, to show others that there is a different alternative, there is a different way, a more excellent way. Each time we come through the fire, we have an opportunity to give hope. Someone who feels hopeless. Each time we come through the fire, we have an opportunity for God to use us to save a life. So failure is not an option. There's too much at stake. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20 declare this: Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body. Someone is looking at you. Someone is counting on you. They are hot. They are parched. They are thirsty. They don't see any way out of the fire. They have been bound. They have no loose clothing. They're covered, hidden. And they need to see Jesus. We are the body. We are the church. We have been called and sent that we might be a beacon of hope. That we might be salt and light. That brings others to living water. That was perfect there. I didn't even find it. They need to see Jesus. They need to see that He is real. They need to see that it's more than stories from an old dusty book. They need to know that He's alive today and alive in us. Why we need to live. That's why we need revival. This is why we need the Holy Spirit. Hear these words from Mother Teresa from her poem called Do It Anyway. People are often unreasonable, illogical, and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of selfish, ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. If you are successful, you will win false friends and true enemies. Be successful anyway. If you are honest and frank, people may cheat you. Be honest and frank anyway. What you spend years building, someone could destroy overnight. Build anyway. If you find serenity and happiness, they may be jealous. Be happy anyway. The good you do today, people will forget tomorrow. Do good anyway. Give the world the best you have, and it may never be enough. Give your best anyway. You see, in the final analysis, it is between you and God. It was never between you and them anyway.
Amen.
Some for me and thee.
sufficient for me, and deep is its fountain, as wide as the sea. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. It's the room at the cross for you.
Amen.